So before beginning, I would like to introduce ma'am to the audience. So our speaker, Dr. Seema Sharma, is an experimental particle physicist and a physics faculty at ISER Pune since April 2014. Her research interests revolve around understanding the fundamental constituents of the universe. She studies proton-proton collisions at high energies of around 13 tera electron volts, delivered by the Large Hadron Collider and detected by the CMS detector. Presently, her research interests are focused on searching for new particles and their interactions, predicted by a theory of elementary particles called supersymmetry. I would like to hand over the virtual mic to ma'am to begin the talk.
Thank you, Neil, for the nice introduction and also to the Science Club for this opportunity to talk to all of you. So as the title of my talks is that whether it's a CMS experiment or a missing momentum microscope. So what I will be talking about has nothing to do with microscope, and the distances we will be trying to probe are much, much smaller than the microscope. This is just a disclaimer or a warning to begin with. Okay, Neil also mentioned the tera electron volts, right? That's the scale of the energy we are talking about. Just to put the things in perspective, the light we are seeing, like which makes us see the things, is essentially of the order of few electron volts. And if I look at the mass of the proton itself, that is of the order of 1 GeV, that is giga electron volt. And we are talking about the energies of the tera electron volt. Now, all where how all these things fit in place that we would discuss. Now, I have tried to keep the talk balanced, a bit of introduction and a little bit of technicalities, but if it goes really too technical, please sort of feel free to interrupt me. Okay, so let's get started. So the brief outline is that I will start with a brief introduction that what are we doing? Why, what exactly the accelerators and colliders, they come in picture for the study of fundamental particles, and what is the current status of our understanding of the universe around us? And then how do we go about searching for the fundamental particles or study them further, okay? So the main idea is what we are trying to do is essentially a quest for a fundamental particles, right? So what is the idea? That what are the fundamental constituents of our universe once we nail them down, but also how they talk to each other, okay? So basically means that how these particles are interacting with each other. In layman's language, I would say that, okay, fine, what are the traffic rules? So as we move ahead,
Ma'am, sorry to interrupt.
Mm-hmm. Are you able to hear me?
Are you? Yes. I think. Are you changing your slides? I think
yes.
We aren't able to see the slides changing.
Oh, this is weird. Are you able to see now, or there
yes,
is a lag?
We can see it now. I think it would be better if you can
now
just keep this
see?
Window. Yes.
Okay. So then I will leave it like this. It's easier for me also. So you're able to see it now, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, cool. Yeah, so what we are talking about, this is the slide probably you missed, but I just said it in words that we are really worried about or trying to study and understand what are the fundamental constituents of universe around us and how do these constituents talk to each other. Basically to say how these particles interact with each other. Now, the mundane matter around us, that what we are talking about is just of the starting from the atom. It's, we all know that it's electron and the nucleus, right? To the best of our knowledge today, the electron is an elementary particle. So what does the word elementary mean here? It basically means that there is no internal substructure, okay? The electron is just electron. We don't know anything going on inside the electron at the moment, okay? And this doesn't mean that it might not be going on. There may be something going on, but to the best of our knowledge, nothing right now. So in other words, you can say that the distances which we could probe, to the best of our knowledge, electron is an elementary particle. Now, but when it comes to the nucleus, we realize that, okay, fine, it is not elementary or fundamental because it's made up of the protons and neutrons. For a long time, protons and neutrons were considered to be the fundamental blocks until we were able to reach those length scales, okay? And now we know that protons and neutrons are made up of the quarks, right? Now, this is also saying that protons and neutrons are made up of the quarks or antiquarks. That's also half of the picture. Okay, that's also an incomplete picture. I will come to the details in the later slides. But for now, what we know is the electron up and down quark, which makes the the neutrons and the protons and the neutrinos, which we inferred from the study of the radioactivity. So these particles were just established for a while. Okay. But we know that all this, what we are talking about was just at the atomic scale, but the whole universe around us is like ranging from distances of the order of femtometer to galaxies and the whole universe around, right? So what our focus of talk today is essentially on this lower length scale. Okay, so subnuclear, subatomic, we all know, subnuclear, we all know, but what is going on? Now, where does it all fit in terms of the bigger picture, or it's like our current understanding of where it all came from? So our modern understanding is essentially from the Big Bang theory, right? I'm not talking about where the time zero started. What I'm talking about that we are here today when we start walking back, right? And I know many of you are super interested in the astrophysics and cosmology, and you have heard these terms about the dark energy expansion, structure formation, the cosmic microwave background radiations, and like whatever is visible stuff. But we are talking about further and further going towards the origin of the things, that what might have happened. So at the accelerators, for example, at the LHC, the energies we are talking about is of the order of tera electron volts, TeV, and that corresponds to something like picoseconds after the origin. Kind of particles might have been existing then. Okay, what might have happened then? Because even we talk about the heavy nuclear interaction and all these things, they are still after these have been combined to nucleons. And what we are talking about, the CMB or the structure formation, that is much, much far away. Okay. So now, study to like really understand the full picture of it, there's a multi-pronged approach which goes on. So it's really a multi-pronged investigation. Why I say so? There is an energy frontier, intensity frontier, and cosmic frontier. The cosmic frontier is what we talk about, all this cosmic background and all the cosmological and astro studies. Okay. And then there is energy frontier. That's what we talk about, the accelerators. That's we are really trying to get the highest energies achieved. And how does it help us? That I will tell you in the next slide. And other is the intensity frontier, which can be the intensity frontier because, for example, neutrinos, right? They don't interact with the matter at all, right? When I say at all, that's sort of an exaggeration because they do, but very, 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 very small, right? So for that, you need very intense beams so that there is a probability that one or two or a small fraction will interact, or the proton decay. As of today, we know that protons don't decay. A free proton I'm talking about. I'm not talking about the nuclear ones, which goes in the radioactivity. They are inside the nuclear field, okay? And then there is an overlap of all these frontiers because at the end we are trying to answer the questions like what is the origin of the universe? If the forces are unified, what can be the new physics beyond like what we already know? What is the sort of dark matter which we have like observed, which is an established fact, or the dark energy? Or so some of the questions are specific to particular areas. And like, for example, we talk about the bigger structures versus the smaller ones. And the bigger questions are sort of an overlapping one. Okay, so that's what when we say there is a multi-pronged investigation, that's what we mean by. So what we will focus on is the energy frontier. Okay. So why the accelerators? Okay, these two bullets which I have written here. So this slide is particularly very simple, and it's, I think, known to all of you. So the first thing is the simple that the higher the momentum of the particle, the smaller is the wavelength, right? That means if we have really high energy particles or high momentum particles, we can really probe the physics at the short distances. If you all remember how the alpha particle was discovered, but at the end of the day, Rutherford used alpha particle as a tool to study nucleon, the nucleus. Okay, so that was the discovery which was established, but then he just uses a tool because realizing that, okay, these are high energy particles of the order of MeV, and they should be able to sort of probe the nuclear scale. That is the basic idea here. Other point is that this energy mass equivalence, which equals mc square. So if I have a lot of energy available to me, I can convert it to make further massive particles and study them, okay? So this is what we practically do at the LHC. So this is the picture which I'm showing. You can see the slide, right? I'm on slide 9 with the LHC picture.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, good. So this is an accelerator and a collider. So you see the two rings here, that is for the two beams, okay? And this is all underground. It's 100 meters underground in the Geneva and France area. There are four experiments. The So I was just saying that so we have four experiments here. So that's where the beams meet. They are like made to cross each other, as you can see here also. So these are the beam pipes referring to, and the green dots represent the proton bunches. Okay, and I was saying that ELISE is used to study more of the coagulon plasma, that kind of scenario. And what we are talking about, CMS and ATLAS, is where we are talking about the high or more fundamental particles from that point of view. Okay, and this tunnel is something like 27 kilometers. Basic idea is simple. We are taking the protons, and we have a setup of really the magnets and the dipoles, and we just accelerate them. Okay, because you can really, the circular ring means basically we have a lot of magnets there. No, so here are some fun facts. Okay, so when I showed you this particular ring, the big one, this is just the last part of the LCM, the CERN accelerator complex. What we actually start with, when we start with the proton beam, we just start with the standard hydrogen. It's hardly like 2 nanogram of the hydrogen which can be used for one particular filling the full ring. So but then we have a series of the various accelerators which have different ranges. So the particles get go through, for example, start as a hydrogen, then they ionized, then it goes through some linear accelerators. Then there is a series of small circular accelerators. And finally is the LHC ring. Now, LHC ring serves two purposes. One is, so when the protons are entering the LHC ring, they are 450 GeV. That is less than half of the TeV. And we are accelerating this to 6.5 TeV. Okay, but the dipole operating temperature, so these are all the superconducting magnets, the dipole ones, and they are really to be operated with the helium, the cold temperatures, and they are really operated at minus 271 degrees centigrade. Okay, and that is still colder than the average outer space temperature, which is still 2.7 Kelvin. And the joke goes around is that once the LHC started, all other experiments started filling the deficiency of the helium, because it's something like 120 tons of the helium is used to keep these magnets at this temperature. Because you have to see that, okay, it's 27 kilometer ring and most of it is like instrumented. The other one is the beam vacuum pressure, which is of the order of 10 to the minus 13 atmospheric pressure. And the reason we have to keep the vacuum pressure so low, because particles have to pass through, right? Even from the, we know that interstellar space is like really empty. That's why particles can come to the Earth. Otherwise, they will interact and just go away. So these are the two important points. The most of the magnets, they are using producing something like 8.33 Tesla, and they are something like 2,000 magnets. I'm not saying exactly the number. I think numbers are all written here, that there are number of main dipole moments are like 1,232. So, and the currents are of the order of like, we can't imagine. It's like 11,000 amperes or so. So these are like, I'm also giving this, just type in fun facts about the LHC and you will get to know a lot of nice, interesting stuff. Okay, so the deal here, what I'm trying to say is that whenever we talk about these high energy accelerators, they always come in steps. There is always a chain of accelerators, because a single accelerator cannot really have that big of range. It's not efficient at all. So what actually happens at LHC? It's essentially in this cartoon. Okay, we have bunches of the protons coming from opposite directions, and we make them cross. It just so happens that this whole energy is concentrated in such a small time and space that it can really create sort of a mini Big Bang. The conditions close to the picoseconds after the mini Big Bang. Okay. Now, the point is that so what exactly is happening when we say that, okay, particles are interacting or protons? What is the internal structure? As you can see in these cartoons, we have three valence quarks, which you're all familiar with. The proton is made up of UUD, two up quarks and one down quark. But there are many quark-antiquark pairs, and there are many gluons inside. Now, depending upon what is the momentum of the proton, the fraction of momentum carried by the gluons and the valence quarks and all these things can vary. That's also like a like sort of the detailed, what we call these studies, the quantum chromodynamics, which comes in picture. Okay, but at the LHC energies, when what we are referring to, at 6.5 dV proton, each of them, the interaction is actually happening in between the individual quarks and gluons. Okay, and they come with some particular probability distribution. Like if you really want to talk about very high energy interactions, then perhaps valence quarks will be the one. And if you talk about the intermediate one, the C quarks can really sort of get into the interaction. So what is happening is that when I'm interacting, so the PP, the proton momenta is 6.5 dV each. But the actual interaction happening depends upon what is the fraction of momenta carried by each of these partons. So either the gluons or the quarks or antiquarks. Now, once this interaction happened here, so this is the interaction point, and I have other particles coming out. Now, here are the two cartoons that what can happen. This blob represents this particular interaction, some big bang, the bang happened. And then it can be, a, for example, quantum chromodynamics interaction, basically quark gluon, some QQ bar pair interacting, or quark gluon interacting and giving us some sort of. Now, why I put this QCD thing? Because this is the strong interaction. So that means the rate is maximal. Okay. And we are colliding these bunches at the rate of like 40 megahertz. So basically 4 × 10⁻⁷ proton neutron collisions at that rate. Most of these interactions, when I say at the 40 megahertz, are like sort of mundane physics for us. What we are interested in, some sort of a dark matter or supersymmetry production or some other new physics coming in, it might be like one event in the 10 billion collisions. So the challenge is, how do we identify such events? Okay. So that's what we will try to see, that what is happening in these interactions. So the first thing is that what kind of particles can be produced in these interactions? What is our current understanding? Our current understanding can be nicely described by the standard model of the particle physics. I hope most of you have heard about it, but in case it is not the case, is briefly introducing. So we know that there are four fundamental forces: the electromagnetic force, the strong force, weak force, and gravitational force. At the elementary particle level, we have these three families of the leptons and quarks. What do I mean? In the beginning, I talked about that our mundane matter that is made up of up and down quark, which form the proton and neutron, and then the electron, which combine with them, they make the atoms. Okay, and neutrinos we have established from the studies from the radioactivity. But then there are three such families. There are two more sets of the quarks and the leptons. So the basically, you can call them cousins, partners, repeated families. But there are three leptons, electron, muon, and taus, and respective neutrinos. And there are three sets of the quarks. And as of our understanding, as of today, the forces among these particles is mediated by the vector bosons. Okay, so photon is a carrier of the electromagnetic forces. The gluons, the mediate the strong forces. W and Z are responsible for the weak forces. So when we talk about the radioactivity, these are the particles which are responsible for. Okay, and that's why it is weak also, because these particles are very heavy. They are something like 90. So this one is 80 and this one is 90 times heavier than a proton, while the photon and gluons are massless. Okay, and most of these particles, like the top quark or the muons or the taus, they decay, or the Higgs boson, they decay to the more stable particles. Now, when I say stable here, it also means in the terms of that the particle produced and the interaction can reach my detector. That is the stability level I'm talking about. For example, a muon. Muon is not forever stable. Okay, it does decay to electrons, for example, at some point in time. But for our purpose, it is stable. So in addition to like the mediation of the forces, the main difference among these families is their masses. So this is increasing in the mass. So the question is that how do they acquire their mass? That is why at the quantum field theory level, our understanding is that they interact with the Higgs field, and that's how they acquire the mass term. And that is what is responsible for the masses. So more the mass, the interaction with the Higgs is higher. That's what happens with the top quark couples very strongly with the Higgs. When I say strongly here, doesn't mean the strong interaction. That's the weak interaction we are talking about. So, and the standard model is a well-established model by now. And once the Higgs discovery is established back in 2012, so this is the picture from the day we announced the discovery. And just on a personal note, I was at CERN at that day when the discovery was announced. And it was a fantastic experience. I mean, you could see that, okay, fine, your equations materializing, which I studied in my master's. So one has to sort of emphasize here that this is the first elementary scalar particle ever observed in nature. Higgs is the only scalar fundamental particle. Okay, and you the plot you see here, this distribution here. Before going into the kinematic details of it, what I would like to say here that the blue one and the green one, which are the filled histograms, they are our known physics. They come from the Higgs standard model without Higgs at the moment, because if the Higgs did not exist, or if I did not have the right amount of data, then I would not see this red one. Okay, because this red one, so my data is showing deviation from the blue one and the green one combined, which is my standard model expectation. And this deviation can be explained by Higgs boson, presence of a Higgs boson in the data with a mass of 126 GeV. Okay, so now the question becomes is that once the standard model is so established, why do we care? Okay. And then comes like there is so much we don't know, and a few fundamental questions which particle physics is trying to address right now that are beyond which standard model cannot explain is that we don't know the, I mean, we still have to understand the fully the electroweak symmetry breaking. Okay, whether this is the standard Higgs boson or not, I think that's more or less established from various studies. But at the same time, we still have to understand theoretically that, okay, what is going on, because if you calculate in standard model, the Higgs mass becomes divergent just by the calculation. But in the nature, we have seen it to be 125 GeV. So there is some sort of discomfort there. Then we know the dark matter is an established problem. Now, what is the nature and identity of the dark matter? All we know it via the bulk interaction on the gravitational effect, right? But we don't yet know what is the fundamental particle which associates with that. Then the other questions are like, what is the origin of matter and antimatter asymmetry in the nature? Or can there be a new symmetry, which can lead to some grand unification of the various forces? Or why the electroweak and the Planck scale? Planck scale is the one where the gravity becomes important. Why they are so different? So these are the like some of the problems which we try to sort of address. The picture on the left-hand side is nothing but the same particles, but in their increasing masses. So you see the first family, second family, and third family, and they are really increasing in the masses. And then there are the intermediate particles, which are like heavy, the W and Z, while the photons and gluons are massless, so they are not coming in here. And the electron, the neutrinos, the masses are known to be like non-zero, but they are very, very small. And we still are trying to sort of, that's like sort of a different field of the research, which is going on. Okay. So today we will focus on the dark matter problem. So that is an established problem from the various astrophysical and cosmological observations. So I'm not going into details of it, but the basic idea is that there are observations that cannot be explained only by the visible matter. If you want to make sense of them, then it tells it, okay, fine, there is a big chunk of mass there and it's non-luminous. And that is what we call dark matter. Dark because it is non-luminous, particles don't interact with it. Okay, so if we think in terms of the particle identity, then perhaps it is some sort of a weakly interacting massive particle. Weakly interacting massive and neutral. It has to be electrically neutral because it's not luminous. It doesn't interact with anything electromagnetically. And if it is strongly interacting, then we would have observed it by now. Weakly because then the probability of interaction with other matter becomes very, very small. That's what happens with the neutrinos. Okay, so to study this, as I said, there is a multi-pronged approach, and there are direct detection experiments, and there are satellite-based experiments, and a lot of stuff going on. But what we will focus on is how we study this as at LHC. Okay, so this is the first one, that the first graph here shows that two standard model particles can interact, and in the colliders, they can produce the two dark matter particles. The direct detection refers to is that there can be a dark matter particle which can interact with a standard model particle, can give you dark matter particle and a standard model particle. So these are the direct detection experiments, which I'm not sort of talking about right now. In the colliders, I think you can see it in simple way here also, that there are two standard model particles. These are essentially our, in PP collision, it will be quarks or gluons. Then they can interact, and there's a force carrying mediator, and it can produce the dark matter. Now the point here to note is that if it is a dark matter particle, or a standard model particle. If it is a dark matter particle, then how can we sort of see it, right? Because my detector will interact with something which is has some interaction. If it doesn't interact, then how do we go about it? That's the topic which I'm going to talk about. The other point is that there's an existence of like direct dark matter, that it may exist, but there are other sort of theories also which can give you some more idea. So one of it is like, if we expect a higher level of symmetry or not. So suppose, if there is a symmetry between fermion and boson, right? So then what happens? So such theories, what they do is that they predict that I can have a sort of equivalence between the fermions and bosons. So spin half particles and spin zero and spin one particles. So for every standard model particle, I can have a supersymmetric partner which is differing by spin one. Okay, but these here are fermions and they here becomes bosons. These are bosons and they become fermions. But these particles then they mix up and they give some sort of a mass state which we call neutralinos. And this particle, if it is lightest supersymmetric particle, that means if it is a stable supersymmetric particle, if it is weakly interacting and if it is electrically neutral, then it is a viable candidate for dark matter. So this is like sort of a very interesting theory and very well established and very sort of well studied theory. I won't say established because we don't have any experimental signature yet. So, and there are models in which the graviton can also become the lightest supersymmetric particle and then it may be the dark matter candidate. So what my sort of research has been involved is mostly searches for the dark matter, and I have done more on the supersymmetry side rather than the direct production side. But the features remain same, the signatures remain same, that in the end, in a PP collision, when my proton-proton collision happened, when my quarks and gluons interacted, in the final state, I got some weakly interacting neutral, electrically neutral particle. That's what is sort of a viable candidate for the dark matter. The signature remains same. Now, supersymmetry has a little bit more interesting properties. So one is I mentioned that the Higgs calculations give us some problems. So if you have the this partners like the top quark and the scalar top quark, then their effects can get canceled in the loops, and then they stabilize the Higgs mass theoretically also. So that is sort of one interest from the theory point of view. Then it is a viable dark matter candidate it provides. Then it also leads to the unification of the various interaction couplings. So that's another interesting feature which can really give you a like sort of a later on the big unification. But the most important thing is that any new theory you pick up, okay, whatever the standard model is established, it should not disturb that because these are experimentally established facts. How my electron and photon is going to interact. If I bring in a new theory and it breaks it apart, and it breaks it apart in a visible way that I can easily sort of comprehend, then something wrong with the theory. So the supersymmetry just happens to be a small perturbation which is consistent with the precision data so far. So it really sort of minimizes any unnecessary perturbation in the standard model. Those results remain as they are within the uncertainties, of course. So next question is, how do we study these collision events? And that's where the CMS detector comes in picture. So, and this is really a technical marvel. So you can see this sort of opened up. So what is happening is that the interaction happens somewhere here at the center. Before I move ahead, people can still hear me, right?
Yes, ma'am, we can
okay,
hear you.
Okay, perfect. So this is what happens that, okay, fine. There is an interaction happening here, this interaction point, and then nearest we have a silicon-based detector, which is what we call tracker. And then we have a electromagnetic calorimeter, which studies the electrons and photons. Then we have a hadron calorimeter, which studies essentially the jets, but internally those are pions or other hadrons. And then there are the muon detectors. Now this part is completely inside a 4 Tesla magnetic field. So when I have the charge particles, they will just sort of give a signature in a bent track. Now, before I move to those details, I'd just like to point out that this total weight of this particular detector is like 12,000 tons. And the overall diameter, if you see from here to there, that is something like 14 to 15 meters. And this length is something like 21 meters. So you can imagine like the scale of the whole thing. Earlier, I used to have some sort of, I think it is hidden behind this E of this muon barrel. That's like sort of, if a human being is standing there, this is the scale would be. So you can see the font size of the barrel here. That is essentially the size of a person standing there. So what happens? So I have this piece of the detector, and one thing is that it is not just a single detector, right? I mean, it is like millions of independent readout channels. Okay, and that we have to sort of combine and infer that what happened at the interaction point. So this is, hopefully we'll make it more clear. So the point is that this is the interaction happened. That's what the picture I showed in that particular bank, which happened. Now then what happens? This interaction happens somewhere here, and then the particles, there is a magnetic field of 4 Tesla. Particles start traveling, so charged particles start bending. The neutrals will go straight and they will interact whichever detector is meant for them. And the muons will just pass through. So they bend because they are charged, but their interaction is very low. So then they just leave a nice track all across. And we can measure its momenta, because once you know the bending, you can really measure your momenta. So the point here is what I'm making is that the basic concept is same what you have been studying in your class 12th or undergrad, right? That the charged particles bending in the magnetic field, you can measure the momenta. They will always lies in the details, and that's what we deal with. Now, 2 points here. So first is this tracker is essentially what happens. You have these hits, you can connect them and get a pattern recognition done, and you can get the track. These are the showers or the signatures by the electron. This is by photon and this is by electron. The one which is bending, the red one, is electron, straight will be photon. And these are the hadrons, the pions, for example. Pions are protons or neutrons. This will be neutron, this will be a proton. And then the muons. Now the point is that we talked about these particles like Higgs, W, Z, top. They just decay into the more lighter ones. And these are the particles which actually travel. Otherwise, the lifetime of top or WZ, they have the order of 10 to the minus 23 to 10 to the minus 25 seconds. So they are never going to reach the detector. Okay? Is there products which reach the detector? And studying them, we infer what happened at that interaction, this particular interaction. This slide just tells about more details that how precise these detectors are relatively. So this will be the most precision and the low momentum. Then the high momentum, these calorimeter measurements take over, and this is for the muons. So let's forget about this one. Now the detail is that here I established that I can measure the electron, pion, muon, any charged particle. This can give me electrons, photons, pions, kions, protons, and muons, right? So these are the particles I can directly measure in the detector. Now what happened to quarks and gluons? We all know that the quarks and gluons, we cannot see them as just like isolated particle, right? They are all confined. So what happens is that they just convert themselves into a collimated spray of hadrons. And these hadrons are stable enough to reach the detector because they are also high momenta, right? So there is time dilation, which means their lifetime scale is a little bit increased. So they can reach the detector. And the first part of the detector is of the order of a few centimeters here. So they can easily manage to reach the detector. What we do, so they, if a quark is coming in from here, for example, it will convert into all these particles and we cluster them together. We have dedicated algorithms for that. So this is what will happen if the particle has come through. But at the detector, we have the detector sets, detector readout, and we cluster them. And from these small deposits, we infer the four momenta of the quark or gluon which might have happened. These are the details of how the jets are made up of. They are made up of a lot of the charged pions, pi plus, pi minus. There are some neutral hadrons like neutrons, and then there is some pi zeros. So usually the fraction is of the order of 1/3 versus 2/3 of the charged pion versus neutral pion versus the charged pions. So the jets are essentially the experimental probe to study the origin of the quarks and original quarks and gluons, therefore momenta. And these jets are really powerful tool because, for example, if I have had a jet coming from the B quark, for example, I am able to identify that. Because when I say that, okay, a B jet, if this was happened to be B jet, it can, the B quark can pick up another U or D or S or C, and it can really sort of create a B hadron. So instead of pion kion, it will have a B hadron, which has a longer lifetime. So then it will have a small displaced vertex. So instead of everything coming from here, there is something coming from here more dominantly. So in that way, we can really identify these B quarks also. And there are, I think this one has been very, very sort of advanced now with and much improved now with all the machine learning techniques. So right now, actually, we are using deep neural networks for identifying the B quark jets. And in addition, these jets can also be used to study very, very high momenta, top quark, W quark, and Z quark. Because when they are high momentum, so if it is a low momenta top, if the top is sitting at rest, then I will have the decay products W and B and W going to QQ bar separately. But if they are very boosted, then I can really get them into a single jet. So in that sense, jets are really our discovery tools. But the most interesting one for our purpose right now is the missing momentum. So what happens is that we talked about this proton-proton interaction. So you see here, if I call this Z direction, the beam direction to be Z direction, there is no momentum here. The Z component is zero. So for the outgoing particles also, I should expect the same, that the momentum in the transverse side should be conserved, right? So if you have something that the in the final component, there is something which is missing, right? So the final transverse component is not zero of the momentum. That means something has flied through the detector without really depositing any signature. It could be a neutrino in the standard model, it can be a dark matter, or it can be a neutrino in the supersymmetry, right? So if I have a way to select all these collisions where I have anomalously high missing transverse momentum, then I have collected dominantly the collisions where my dark matter candidate might have been produced. A dark matter interaction might have happened, right? So this picture here on the right shows the missing ET. This ET miss is what we call either missing transverse energy or missing transverse momentum. We interchangeably use this. And if you see, this is what is expected from the non-physics. And if there are any detector problems, then also I can have this kind of scenario. Okay, so before going to details of this, let me just bring up one point here. For example, this is what happened. You can see this picture here. Yeah, you are this visible, right? Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
So for example, this is one interaction, and we are looking at the direction of the beam, that how the detector would look like. So in the transverse direction, no, transverse to the beam. So you see, when I sum up all these vector momenta, so all these, the blue ones and red ones are essentially referring to the energy recorded in the detector, and this is what we are recording here, the jets. Okay, and the here, for example, the red one is just a muon, and then this purple one is what my missing transverse momentum is. Okay, and it's a huge, I mean, when I say 600 GeV, is basically like 600 times the proton, the if I really use them interchangeably. So, but looking at this one, I just can't say that whether this one is a neutrino or whether this is a supersymmetry particle or whether this is a dark matter particle, right? So all you can do is do a statistical analysis, right? So you try to select or like really separate out these kind of collisions where you have a large missing transverse momentum and see whether it fits with your standard model picture or not. Okay, so this is the basic idea which is illustrated here. This is how we go about the searches. For example, the first plot here, if I plot the mass of the particles which I'm looking at, so invariant mass of the decay products. So if I take, for example, a Z boson, and it can decay to two leptons, two electron, like electron and positron. I measure the electron positron. And if I look at, I sum up their four momenta, I take the square. That is an invariant quantity. Okay? If I do that, then if there is a Higgs, this is something which we did in Higgs boson, right? We looked at the Higgs going to four leptons via two Zs, and I'm looking at the mass of this one. And you see here, this peak is essentially nothing but it's sort of like peaking at the original particle. Okay, but then there can be, for example, if I look for the dark matter kind of searches, and I selected this sort of some collisions where I'm expecting very high missing momentum, then you can see here, this is the kind of search we do in the case of the dark matter, for example. I pick up all the collisions where I have the missing transverse momentum greater than some threshold, and I histogram them. I basically make a frequency distribution of them. And at some point, there might be an excess with respect to the non-physics. For example, in this case, my wallet is supposed to be a non-physics. Okay, this is just a cartoon to represent that we are really doing the tail search. So we are trying to see an excess of the events or the collisions with respect to what is the non-physics. Okay, now a slight technical detail now. So this one I am talking about the supersymmetry production because this is one of the interesting one that it represents also the how the various interactions happen. So for example, here the orange, and so this is on the log scale, and it is the cross section in the picoband. In a very simple way, you can think this is the probability of the interactions. Okay, that how strongly an interaction can happen, or what, if I say, for example, have 1 year of data, what is the maximum possibility of interaction to happen? So the orange one and the blue one and green one, they all go via the strong interaction, and hence their probability is very high. The other ones, lower ones like the magenta, violet, and the brown ones are essentially coming from the electroweak interactions, and they are mainly the weak interactions here, and their probability is much lower. Okay, and this is one example. I said that all these particles are very heavy. So suppose I have two gluonos produced, they finally end up into dark matter candidates, but there can be very complex decay chains. So what I will see in my detector will be a lot of jets, but there can be leptons, but there will be a lot of missing transverse momentum also. Okay, so we will have the strong production, we will have the top and bottom, which are massive particles again, and have special properties because we can identify them separately. And then there are the electroweak production. So going again, so what we do essentially is that it's a little bit of particle physics introduction, in the sense that if I have a W boson, it decays either to the leptons, which can be like 33% of it. It can go to electron, it can go to a muon neutrino, it can go to a toy neutrino, or it can go via QQ bar, which is just the jets. Now, in case of the TT bar production, then we will have two Ws coming out, because each top decays to B and W, and each W can go one of these channels. So you can really write down the probability of these things, and you can see that in case of the top, I will have 46% of the events where there is no lepton at all. It will be all jets, okay? But there can be rest 10% each where we have a electron. That means high missing energy. We have the electron, but the electron is always accompanied by a neutrino, just for the lepton number conservation. And neutrino will give me large missing ET. Similarly, in case of the, like, if I have a gluino-gluino production, which is supersymmetry production, and I have four tops, then I can make these branching fractions again and figure out, like, how many, what is the sample? I have zero leptons, like no electron, no muon, no jaws, only jets. And what we'll have in the one of these leptons, or same sign, or so there are various combinations which are possible. Now, why did I bring up this thing? The reason I bring up this is because if I'm searching for a supersymmetry scenario, and for example, only with jets, right? Then my standard model contribution should be only this blue one, right? If I'm looking for a one lepton one, then I'm concerned with only this section. Because at the end of the what we are trying to do, we are trying to have this one, which is huge cross section, versus this one, which is very small cross section, right? So it's very important to understand that whatever collisions you are studying, what is your standard model composition there? That is one of the key components that we have to sort of really design our searches with. Otherwise, you cannot claim the, if you put in all the 1 billion events, and just make some distributions, you are not going to claim a discovery. That is the point, okay? So these are the few examples, and we don't have to get into detail. What I want to highlight here is that, for example, the first one, the blue one is how my signature new physics will look like. While the histograms, the solid histograms, are essentially what my standard model backgrounds are, or the standard model processes are. And what is it is, I've selected some few handful of the collisions, the collision events, where I have large missing transverse momentum. And all I have made is a frequency distribution of that. That how many events do I have in from 100 to 200 GeV, or 200 to 300, 300 to 400, and so on. Okay, these histograms, the solid ones, represent what are my standard model expectations. The black one presents what I expected in the data, what I observed in the data, not expected, okay? And I see my observed is consistent with the expectation. That means there is no new physics. If there was a new physics with my sort of model where I have the dark matter, it would have looked like the blue one. So then the black points would have really sort of followed the blue one. So that is the basic idea, that most of our time goes in understanding the detector and trying to understand and measure these solid histograms, which is essentially the standard model backgrounds. Now, you can always say that, okay, fine, standard model is well established, what's big deal? There is big deal, because we are looking into the very sort of tough phase space here. We are not looking at inclusively that, okay, fine, I looked at all standard model processes. So that's what make it challenging and interesting as well. So these are the different ways. I mean, I just picked up some example distributions. That what I want you to point to is that in this different, for example, this is where all jets are there, and you can see that WTT bar and Z invisible, the green one and the red one, becomes dominant. While you look at the two lepton final states, when your collision has the two electrons or two muons, then you see that, okay, the background distribution is slightly different. So these things help us to establish the systematic uncertainties. The statistical uncertainties are straightforward. The main deal is this systematic uncertainties, right? So we design our searches in the different constituents of what will be the what I'm observing in the collision event. Okay. Now, in principle, I can stop here to take a pause, and because the I can continue, but a little bit more technical then, and I'm not sure how many you are following beyond this point. So that you have to tell me.
Ma'am, I think, I mean, if it's fine, you can pause to answer the questions in the chat.
I mean, what I have, this is a general picture of it. I can go into the specific of a background estimation, which might be technical or might be interesting to you, that you people have to tell me.
I think, I mean, if you answer the questions first,
sure,
like everyone would be on the same page.
I agree with that. No questions, that means everybody understood everything. I'm happy.
Ma'am, there are some questions in the chat.
Ah, sorry. There are a lot of chats. Okay. So somebody asked, what are the electroweak and Planck scales? So the electroweak scale we are talking about when you are able to sort of comprehend the electromagnetic interactions and the weak interactions. Now, the electroweak, we say it because the electric force and the electromagnetic force and the weak force, they are essentially the two sides of the same coin. That's what we call the electroweak unification. Okay, and the energy scale we are talking about is of the order of 80, 90, 100 GeV. So that is of the order of WZ or Higgs mass. The Planck scale is where the gravity becomes important, or gravity becomes comprehensive, or like if influential to these fundamental particles or these atomic mass scales, right? When I talk about the electron interactions or the Higgs boson interaction, the gravity doesn't play any role. So that's what we sort of identify, that, okay, fine, these are the two scales.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. Aditya said that, are we trying to find out a particle which interact only through the known forces, or can we find new force carrier? Well, I think right now the way it works is that we have some idea what we want to look for, but at the same time we try to keep the searches in a way that that should be able to sort of indicate if any deviation from standard model. So as an experimentalist right now, any deviation from standard model, I will be super happy. And then we go about characterizing. So for example, in my slide, this slide itself is showing. So suppose if I look at the last figure here, and if I see some axis here, in this case, the data is consistent with these histograms, but suppose I saw something up. Suppose my data, this data point was somewhere up. Okay, so then I can say that, okay, fine, yes, I have found something which has an axis of the missing transverse momentum, right? But at that moment, I cannot say it's a direct dark matter, it's a supersymmetric dark matter, or something else going on. So then comes the characterization of the things, and there we start finding out what exactly is the physics is referring to. The same thing we did with the Higgs boson. We find out some mass state that is 125 GeV. So in collisions, we have a new particle produced which has this mass of 125 GeV. Now, whether it's a standard model Higgs, or whether it's some Higgs predicted by this SUSY, or it's predicted by some double Higgs doublets, many things which can go on. So then comes the characterization. So you look for their CP properties, you look for their parity properties, you look for their angular distributions, you look for their interaction with the other standard model particles, and see if it is consistent with the standard model prediction or some new thing which we are seeing. Okay, so this characterization comes once we have some deviation with respect to the standard model. So we try to keep it as generic as possible. Another question is, what are the energy scales associated with the SM-SM to DM-DM processes? Now, as I said, the protons are really accelerated at the 6.5 GeV, but the particles we are talking about, it all depends upon what is the dark matter mass. Okay, suppose the dark matter is some sort of a 100 GeV particle each, then you need 200 GeV to produce. But if the dark matter itself is 500 GeV, then we need at least 1 GeV to produce it, right? So the scale will depend upon what is the final state particle you want to produce. So for example, if you want to produce Z boson, it's 90 GeV, right? But at the same time, if you want to produce a TT bar pair, then it is 117 to 2, so 340 GeV. So that depends upon what is the mass of this final state particle you want to produce. And that's where it's important to have, like, that's how the hadron machines help. So instead of proton-proton collision, I can have electron-electron collision also. Right, but then the electron is being a single particle, an elementary particle, will have exactly one energy, what my accelerator is tuned for. But if we have a proton-proton, then it allows us to scan, because constituent protons, the gluons or quarks, can have multiple different energies, right? It goes by distribution. So that allows you to probe different energy scales. That is the idea. So I think I did not show it. I think I was about to come to that later. So for example, this one. So the plot here is essentially what I'm saying, that I have a gluino and I have neutralino. So gluino is the strong particle produced at the PP interaction. It can be from 500 GeV to 2.5 TeV. Okay. And the y-axis is where I'm producing this dark matter candidate, which is this decay product, which is coming in here. So it can go from 200 GeV, 400 GeV up to like 1400 GeV. It can be much more also. But we don't have that much of data and energy yet to produce those particles with the right probability that we can see it in our analysis. Right? So we are not really searching for a particular energy scale. So we try to be as much as possible. Aditya has another question. What is the whole family of supersymmetric particles? You just double the standard model particles, but then we need to have a little bit more on the Higgs side, that we have more Higgs particles.
Yeah, hello.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Can I expand on my question?
Sure.
So when you said supersymmetric particles, are you trying to look for only one order? I don't have much idea on the supersymmetric particles.
That's fine.
But you defined it as a pair, like a different kind of particles which differs from the standard model particles by one spin.
Yes.
So is there only one such family, like apart from the standard model, or we can have different families based on the different spins?
What I am talking about here is the minimal extension of the standard model. So this is what we call MSSM, minimal supersymmetric standard model. Okay, for there we have exactly just one family. Only detail is here, if you look in this picture here, if I say my standard model, I have only one Higgs boson.
Okay.
Right? Theoretically, I have only one Higgs field you are talking about. But here you need to have two of them if you have the supersymmetry. Right? So then you will see more Higgses, more mass particle states, which we haven't yet observed in the PP collision data of last 4 years of running.
Okay.
Okay. So another question is, how is the bend measured? Because these are small, Abhinav has one question.
Okay.
How is the bend measured? Because these are the small particles. So in accordance with quantum mechanics, how do we note their trajectory? Very good. So if you see this particular picture, right? It was not this visible in the other detector picture I showed, but this is exactly what is happening, that we have these small circles here and these circles. So what we have there is essentially some silicon detectors, right? Very thin detectors. So as the charged particles are passing through, they will create some ionization, right? And these are all in the reverse bias. So when they create the ionization, it's essentially the electron hole pairs, because this is the like semiconductor detectors, and that we collect the charge and we get the electric pulse, right? So then you can see, if I look at particular trajectory, for example, I will have a hit here, I will have a hit here, I will have a hit here, hit here, hit here. While the neighboring ones, there is no signature. So once I know this thing, I can do a pattern recognition. Okay, and from this pattern recognition is when you, how you measure your, so if I would have a straight line versus a bend line, right? So I can measure this agita, I can measure this bending. And that essentially gives me the momentum measurement. Is this what you are asking, Abhinav?
Sure, but I was asking in context of that apparatus, that barrel kind of thing. I don't know what it is like named.
This one, right?
When you said that lever, yeah, this one. So
yeah.
Is it the same?
Exactly. So if I look at that particular picture which I showed,
thanks.
So this one is the closest to the detector. Okay, and it starts with like first few centimeters, first layer. So if you look at in the beam direction in transverse space, so project it on the circle, so it will come out to be a circle, right?
Right.
That's what we are. Yeah. So these are just a different way of representing the same things. So this is what
we are. So we are measuring it consecutively.
Exactly. So we just get hits and we can do pattern recognition. But you know what? It's a very simplistic picture. If you really see what is happening is like this picture, right? Just a bang happens and a lot many particles will come out. What is not clear from this picture is that we have millions of independent channels, which means the that it's of the order of few hundred microns in XY axis. So you can imagine the small pixels of the order of few like 100 microns by 100 microns. Right? So even if this many particles are coming out, not two particles will go through the same cell.
Okay.
Right? That probability is very small. So we can really get a nice trajectory and we can do a pattern recognition. That's what we call tracking fitting.
Okay.
Okay.
Ma'am?
Yeah.
So in the graph where there was a list of masses of the different particles,
mm-hmm.
The masses of neutrinos were like sort of explicitly mentioned that like the ranges, but from what I know, there was a upper bound on the sum of the neutrino masses. So
yes, it's just
has
indicative.
There been any progress after that?
It's just indicative, nothing more than that.
Okay.
It's what our wish list would be.
Okay,
perhaps
okay.
This is what is going on, but not necessarily.
Okay.
In fact, we don't even know the mass the hierarchy right now, whether it's this way or the inverse and all that stuff, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
In fact, we know only the delta masses, right? I mean, I don't think we have more understanding of the exact masses right now.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
I'm sorry if I missed any questions or I have taken...
Ma'am, there was just one question at the beginning. The question was, how stable are the neutrinos and where are they from?
How stable are the neutrinos?
Yes.
If they are the smallest particles, then they are stable. If they don't have anything to decay to.
Okay, and next part was, where are they found?
Where are they found? All over. I don't have the number in my off my head right now, but many of them are passing through our bodies even now. Okay. Now, think in terms of for example, what is happening in the sun, the reaction in the sun, where how we are getting heat. Does anyone know?
Nuclear fusion.
Yes, and there the weak interactions are involved, right?
I don't have much idea about that.
Anyone? There are people interested in astrophysics, I know. Okay. I think it would be interesting to check because then you will be able to connect to the basic particles also. But there are also weak interactions going on there. Okay. So the solar neutrinos is one of the things which is sort of very, very actively being studied right now. In fact, a lot of our knowledge on the neutrinos come from the solar neutrinos studies.
All I have read that the way we detect them is we have a huge water tank and then they pass through and then very rarely one of them it hits and we detect it.
Exactly. So this is exactly what the problem with the dark matter searches also is, right? Because neutrinos are not electrically charged, right? Now, if you really sort of appreciate this fact, when I said these particles passing through the detector, right? These can be 1 TeV, 5 TeV, whatever TeV. At the end, when I'm seeing the recorded signal or recordable signal, then it is really interaction with the atoms and nucleus of this material, right?
Yeah.
Right? So if you have a neutrino, which neither interacts strongly because it doesn't have the correct quantum numbers and properties, it doesn't have electric charge, so it cannot react with the atomic electrons, then it just passes through, right?
Yeah.
But the detail is that it can still have the weak interactions, right?
Yeah.
And the quarks have the strong charge also, they can interact strongly. They also have the electric charge, they can interact via electromagnetic interaction, but they also have the weak charge, right? The correct quantum numbers which can allow them to interact weakly. So occasionally what happens, a neutrino can interact with a quark, right? And there it can produce something which can give us some recordable signal, right? So suppose it's an electron neutrino coming from sun.
Okay,
so then it can interact with the quark or something and it can give us an electron then, right?
Okay.
So that will give you a little bit kink somewhere in this big tank you're talking about. So that's what we call sometimes the hadronic recoil, or sometimes like when it's interacting with the nuclear part, or it, I mean, it's very small signatures which come in. The, I gave the example of the electron, so then it should give us the some electron signature,
mm-hmm.
some electron track if there's a magnetic field.
Mm-hmm.
But the most interesting part for me is that how these particles talk to the material, the detector material. And that's where all fun begins.
Ma'am, so have we not detected any dark matter interactions at all in like the in the LHC?
So we, that's what I said, that we have the collisions, which is like dark matter like, right?
Okay.
But the rate which we have detected them with is consistent what we expect from standard model.
Okay.
Okay, so then we can't say that we have seen anything beyond a standard model.
Mm-hmm.
Right, that is all the fight going on right now. But there are more analyses
Hello.
Which are still going on. Yes, Aditya.
Yeah. Yeah, so if we we are going to the FCC.
Mm-hmm. Hello, I think I dropped you.
Just circular collider.
Mm-hmm. Aditya, I cannot hear you, whether it's my internet
Hello.
Or your...
Hello.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, yeah. So with the possibility of the FCC, Future
mm-hmm.
Circular Collider,
mm-hmm.
can we expect to observe signals of dark matter and supersymmetric particles there?
So that will be a lot of data. That will be 10 times more data than what we will have now. Okay, next 2 years.
Yeah, but in terms of the...
So, yes, I mean, the options are all open, right? And as an experimentalist, I am searching for the new physics. Right, so our hope is there. We have not yet ruled out all the possibilities even for the FCC. Okay, but in addition to these searches, direct searches, we are also going for the very precision standard model measurements. So both combined, I hope we will be able to see something. I mean, that's what I believe in.
Okay, thank
okay.
you.
Okay, but the FCC is still far ahead. We are, sorry, I confused. I think I replied to our means. I replied to your question, but in an incorrect way. So FCC you're talking about is far-fetched. My answer was for the high luminosity LHC. So when I said 10 times more data, that was for the high luminosity LHC. Okay, and that will be sort of next step. But HLLHC will run only at the same energy, 13-14 TeV. What you're talking about FCC is much higher energy. There definitely we will have something. Okay, that's what the expectation
okay.
is. So
okay.
I'm sorry, I replied to your first, I mean, the first part of it was incorrect on my part. Okay, so the high, even with the high luminosity LHC, I think that's something which work is already going on. So what is expected is basically this, what I was talking about. The mistake which I made to answer your question is this, that right now we are here, right?
Yes.
In 2020. Okay, so right now the LHC is not running. So next 3 years, again, LHC will run and we will collect data. So we will double up the data we have collected so far. But then there is again some shutdown and there will be a lot of upgrades on the magnet side also and accelerator side also, but at the same time on the detectors also. And then we will really run at the 10 times more intense beams. Okay, so that we will go on running for the 10 years. So FCC is still a little bit far fetched, but all the developments for the FCC starts soon. I mean, they have to start sooner, otherwise we won't be able to cope up. Okay, the HLLHC itself is a very challenging one because the beams are very intense. So this is what will happen. So what I am presenting here is a small picture, which is like a clean interaction, two photons coming out. Hopefully it was like Higgs 2 gamma gamma event, right? And because the beams will be so intense that I can have multiple pairs of the quark gluon interacting. And then we have to figure out which is the collision of our interest. Because all these will be mundane physics. Okay, and really figuring out in a given collision or given beam crossing, what happens, given bunch crossing, what happened is going to be very sort of fun stuff. Actually, that's why our detectors are being upgraded now, because in that kind of environment, this particular piece of the detector, which is essentially in the direction of the closer to the beam, they won't be able to survive the radiation damage. So we are already trying to update these detectors. So this will be like silicon and the scintillator based. So in fact, one of my students is heavily involved with this, and this is what we call the high granularity calorimeter. And you see, even though we will start all these things later in around 2027, the prototype testing and the detector building is already starting. So I think some of you might know Shubham. He has been working with me here. But he was at CERN, and we were trying to sort of prepare for the test beams. And some of these small setups I have here in my lab also, which we are trying to sort of understand what is going on with these small things. But you have to appreciate the fact that this hexagonal board here, which I'm showing, basically on the middle, lower, this figure, that is just one piece of the detector. And we will have something like 20,000 of such modules. So you can imagine the scale. So these small setups, we can study locally in various institutes across the globe, right? We can develop our own readouts, and we can really sort of try to understand what exactly happening in the detector and what the calibration will look like, where we will fail with the calibration, what is the temperature sensitivity, stability, all these things can be studied for long. Then we have the test beams where we shoot the particles of the known identity and known energy. So right now we have taken data with the positrons and pions. Okay, so we are studying this to understand what is the calorimeter resolution, what is the response, what is the stability, all these things. And then it goes in the final somewhere. But all these developments and studies really go across the globe. It is not just like only at CERN and everything is going on at CERN. That is not like sort of a correct picture. I think this setup we have here also, it was an old one. But this one has been already updated. And this is like what they used for the test beam, that when the electron passed through, how each of these channels will respond. And we really collect data from there and try to see what was the energy of the original electron. So I think the fun part is essentially to connect these pieces, like what is actually happening in your detector, to understand it as an experimentalist, to worry about the correct calibrations, to worry about the malfunctioning, because that can give you fake dark matter signature. And then come to the final money plots, what we call. These are the summaries, for example. So if I look into, like, for example, this particular figure here, on x-axis is the Gluino mass, right? If my Gluino can be 1 TeV, Gluino can be 2 TeV. And the upper one, the y-axis is essentially my neutrino mass, which is WIMP, weakly interacting massive particle. And the mass range, this one, since Gluino decays to this one, this mass has to be less than Gluino mass always. Just the basic kinematics. A decay product cannot be more heavier than the mother particle. That's why this is blank, this side. Not kinematically allowed. Now, whatever you see inside this curve is practically ruled out in a particular model we have studied. And the various curves refers to the results from the collision samples, which have either no electron muon tau, or it can have a single electron or muon, or it can have multiple electrons or muons. Okay, so that's what like sort of helps us to understand that which kind of scenarios are more powerful as compared to the others. Like, so for example, you can see that in this case, the red and blue one are more powerful as compared to the leptonic ones, while in the right one, the leptonic one is more powerful than the hadronic ones. So these are the sort of the interfaces we try to make. But I would like to say it here that okay, theory for us then becomes just a guidance to sort of get started with the things. That's not the final word on that. So as a sort of, as an experimentalist, my result is I measured all my backgrounds and I compared with the observed data, whether I see an excess or is it consistent with the standard model. So all these numbers, basically my backgrounds and the corresponding uncertainties and the observed data, that is the experimental result. Now, you can use this data to interpret in the SUSY models. You can use this data to interpret in some exotica models or some extra dimension models, or you can do it in the dark matter models, depending upon how your search is designed and what it will be sensitive to. But the key point is that given a proton-proton collision, I really cannot say what exactly this event is. I can only say something when I have a statistical ensemble of such collisions and try to see whether it is consistent with my known knowledge or not. If you see a deviation, then it will be much more fun. That's what happened actually when we discovered the Higgs, right? When we saw the deviation with respect to the non-physics, and there was the fun was, that was the discovery announcement. I think somebody commented, I know neutrinos are present in the cosmic rays. That's also correct. What else? I think then are the details, like how we really design our searches so that, see, what you have to understand is that this is a,
hello?
Yeah,
can you,
go ahead.
Yeah, can you say the number of particles like which we observe in a typical collision? Why am I asking is because I'm a master student and I'm working on heavy ion collisions at RIG. So if we have if we have new particles, do you have enough statistics to study their flow properties, transport properties, etc.?
Yeah, so the CMS both CMS and ALICE, they do record the both the PP and the PBPB collision data, right? The lead collision data, or it's not only lead, it's also with the gold, right? The gold atoms.
Yeah.
So yes, so I think if you want to do anything with the proton-proton physics, there is huge amount of data available because it's all in strong interactions, right? Now the only detail becomes is that whether we have the right centrality or not, if that's what you're talking about. So CMS also releases results. We also study the both the heavy ion collision and compare them with the proton-proton collisions. That's a very interesting topic to compare the two and try to understand that, okay, it makes sense or not.
Yeah, because in CMS, what I understand is it's basically comparing the standard model data to the expected dark matter scenarios. So if we can compare the transport properties as well, we can get some good insights, I guess.
So I'm not sure whether you're talking about the transport properties you're talking about is doable in CMS or not. But I know that, okay, all this jet suppression or the Jepsi suppression and some of these nucleonic properties, they are all done in the CMS. It's like very nice results, I would say. I did not compare with the ALICE ones or the RIC ones. But for example, LHC also provided some sort of an intermediate atoms, right? We did the lead-lead, but then it was also the gold-gold. And then also the proton-lead and the proton-proton. So whatever is possible, that is being studied. That is true.
Okay, thank you.
I won't say, okay, so here I just talked about only like when you're trying to see in the extreme phase space where we have a lot of missing transverse momentum and try to see whether, okay, fine, this is coming from the known physics, so there is something new there. But a lot of work is going on in the standard model measurements itself. Because if you do the precision measurement, then you can make out that, okay, if there is a deviation, then maybe some new physics is hidden there. If you can reduce your uncertainties on measurement, maybe some physics is hidden there.
Okay.
So
thanks a lot.
So that is always there. What else? Any other question or anything I missed on the chat window?
Ma'am?
Yeah?
So I had a small question. Why are the detectors hexagonal?
Ah, that one.
Like, is there a reason or is it for some sort of convenience?
Yeah, it's, I think, the manufacturing convenience. And to minimize the gap, detector, the pictures which I showed earlier, it is not. This is the new detector which is coming up for the upgrades. Okay. Now, these are like silicon-based, right? So one, you have to keep in mind that how the silicon, these modules will be manufactured from the foundries. Other is, suppose instead of silicon, you took the circular one, then you have the gaps between the modules, right? There will be empty spaces. So you lose the particles going through. We could do, for example, the square ones, but I think that is related to the production itself. So that's industrial prototypes which comes in picture.
Okay. Well, it's interesting because, you know, 20,000 of such plates are being manufactured. So I thought, you know, they could maybe make some adjustment.
No, so the, yeah, so 20,000 goes in some layers. So for example, in this one, these, you can think of these black ones are essentially silicon modules, and in between they are lead layers.
Okay.
And here it will be steel layers and the silicon layers. And then it will be steel layers and the simulator layers. Actually, if there is an interest, I can come back some point in time and I can really talk about only the how the particles interact with the matter and how we really build up these detectors. Because those details I could not get through. For example, what I'm talking about is... I mean, what I mean is the basic detection concepts. Like, for example, here. Here, I did not tell you the details of the what does the ionization law, like, how does it go? Like, for example, if I have very, very low energy particles of the order of MeV or sub-GeV, I can actually differentiate. The energy deposit will be very different by the low energy pions or kions, for example. So that's what we call particle identification. And that can be done, for example, in the Bell experiments, Bell experiment in the Japan, because it's meant for some of those details, right? Why we are not doing the low energy particle identification here. But it is doable. That's what we call the DDX. What is the energy deposit per length? But as you go to the high momentum, that's how the muon passes through. This is what we call the minimum ionizing particle. But when you come to the electrons and the hadrons, it's electron, photon, hadrons, that's what we call the electromagnetic shower or the hadronic shower. That's how they deposit their energy. So you see, this particular figure is not at scale fully. Okay, so there are details involved. But you can see that, okay, fine. If I want to measure a high energy photon, I need to really have a thick detector. So for example, the current electromagnetic calorimeter we have is of the order of 25 to 20, 30 centimeters, while the hadron calorimeter is of the order of a meter. Right, so these are some sort of interesting detectors. For example, I did not tell you that, okay, fine, in the muon section, the red ones, because what happens is the high PT muon will go just almost a straight line. So we want to have a more lever arm, right? We can measure something so that we can have more bending. Now, these are gas detectors. What I'm putting it here, the brown ones. So the red ones is the iron yoke, right? That is to contain the magnetic field, which is coming out of this four Tesla magnetic, the iron core. So here you see bending again. So that means there is a magnetic field here also. But these are the gas detectors and they work again like cells. So I have a hit here, I can do a pattern recognition then. You see nicely going through. While the all the brown ones are the ones which are empty, nothing happened there. Okay, and the concept here, I don't know, I believe you people might have heard about the Geiger-Müller counter or either already done an experiment on that, I'm not sure. But the concepts essentially start with the gas detectors is from there, right? But then you can have all kind of advanced stuff. So if, I mean, you can tell me later sometimes, I mean, if there's an interest, I can come back with that.
That would be really nice.
Ma'am, I had a question about the last slide.
I can't hear. Is it Saiketh?
Ma'am?
Huh.
Hello?
Am I audible?
Yeah. Am I audible?
I think two of you are speaking together, Rajay and...
Yeah.
I'll wait.
Okay. So Saiketh, please go ahead.
Okay. I did not have a question of that kind, but it was a general thing. I mean, I was asking, I have heard in 2008, I guess, when LHC had their first run of, LHC was about to carry out its first run of experiment by accelerating two protons and studying their collision, right?
Right.
So there, at that time, basically, we were kids and the news channels, they were showing that a historic experiment is going to take place and there are major risks involved. Like, there was this theory, I mean, they were telling us that the particle collisions could create a black hole and then maybe something like that. I mean, so I wanted to ask that is, I mean, there have been multiple experiments related to particle collisions, right? So, I mean, is there any risks involved?
So, I mean, I've been working on this for like, since, okay, yeah. I did my PhD also on the CMS, but once the data taking started, the LHC started in 2009. we are all alive, right? Nothing that happened. Don't
yeah,
worry.
I mean, not in that sense
So,
that the
no.
black hole
Okay,
was
apart from
bad. That
jokes,
was way too much
yes.
exaggerated.
Apart from the jokes, I mean, even if some mini
Yeah.
black holes are produced, okay, the expectation is that they will just evaporate. I don't think LHC is going to produce the black holes in the sense of the black holes, what we talk about, the cosmological arrestor scales.
Yeah.
Okay, so some of the
So that
models are
was
like,
one thing,
yeah.
like, I mean.
So this can be like sort of mini, micro, nano black holes kind of things, but the expectation is that they will immediately evaporate. So instead of seeing these nice clusters of the energy, you will see a lot of energy in the detector.
Okay. But it
So
hasn't been, I mean, detected yet, I
no,
guess.
nothing like
Mine
that.
is still there.
So exactly. So we have sort of like there can be scenarios when you have a lot of jets produced, like a lot of quarks and gluons coming out.
Yeah.
So or like for example, what one of the other person said that okay, fine, it could be like a heavy ion collision, a lot of things coming out. Now there, what happens again? We do the same statistical analysis that we separate out these collisions, these collision events, where we see such scenario, where we see such signatures that the whole detector is lit up. Right, and when you compare with the again that okay the data, and we don't see any right. So far we have only put the limits that up to here is excluded, up to here is no chance, right? In some models, but so far there is nothing like that has happened. So as of now, no signatures of the black hole.
Okay. I mean,
Yeah.
I was just asking this out of
Yeah.
curiosity, because at that
Actually,
time,
no, that's a fair
it
question.
was a kind of many people were like putting this and their own theories and all. I mean, it
Yeah.
was become a mini conspiracy kind of thing at that.
Yeah, not okay. When you said 2008, I thought you will talk about the accident which happened at LHC that
Yeah. I mean, an
with
accident also occurred later on, I guess.
Yeah. No, those are like sort of panic mails, but nothing of that sort.
Yeah.
Ajay, you had some question.
Yeah, ma'am, I had a question about the last slide. There was a graph in which the pink line, it had circles and something.
This one?
Yes, ma'am. The
Okay.
pink line on the right one. It is behaving very not regularly,
Epigenetic,
like,
yeah.
yeah. So is it just a
So,
statistical
okay.
variation or
It's a
we have
statistical.
not?
No, it's a
Okay.
statistical. So what happens is that, as I mentioned, like whatever inside these curves is essentially excluded out in these particular models, right? But then I can't say that, okay, supersymmetry is ruled out. But these particular models in particular production mode and decay mode is ruled out. But now in this scenario, what happens is that, as I said, that this is the mother particle, right? This is the particles we are trying to sort of generate, right? So this could be essentially this particular figure, right? So I had the PP collision, something happened, it's quark, gluon, 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 quark, quark. And we have the two supersymmetry tops produced. So these are scalar tops. And they decay to a top and the dark matter candidate, the neutralinos. So I have two tops in the final state and I have seven singularity. Now, the point here is that the if you want to go in this channel and where top is real, okay. Not a virtual one, then your s-stop mass has to be greater than mass of these two. Right? Now, top mass is well established. We know it very well. It's of the order of 175 GeV. But these are the masses we are trying to prove. Okay? That's what that vertical line presents. That my this mass cannot be heavier than sum of the subtraction of this minus this, right? The s-stop minus top, that is the max I can have. That's what we call the kinematic limit here. So this is what is this line, first line here is referring to m of s top is equal to the m of the neutralino and the top. Now at this range, at this particular scale, what happens is that your the new physics part and the top are very, very sort of on top of each other, and particularly in this range. So your missing it is very, very small. It's not like better, much better than the standard model one. Not very, very small in absolute sense, but not much better than what I would expect from the standard model. So then the fluctuations are very large. This is all smoothened down in the new data. So this one is still from the older. I forgot to update this one, but the ones which we have with the new analysis, this part has been sorted out. This is more smoothened out now. But it's a good catch. It's a good question.
Thank you.
Good. because at the end it's just the sort of like what we are talking about. If you really see the most sensitive regions which will come out, this is the number of collision events on the y-axis here. And you see here, like in the tails of when we have the high missing ET, large missing ET ones, then it essentially comes out to be all, I think this will be, okay, I don't have it here, the missing ET one. For example, this one. If you're talking about, then we are talking about really 1 to 10 events, 1 to 10 collisions, right? So the statistical uncertainties are also large.
Ma'am, I had a question.
Yeah.
Can you explain the role of quantum computing in its in the data analysis? You even mentioned it.
I mentioned it because I know that CERN and Fermilab both have some sort of activities going on there. But I will have to come back to you with any useful comments there.
Okay.
I haven't really sort of paid attention. Quite a few things going on, interesting stuff going on. So one is this, all this detailed, advanced, I did not talk about neural network stuff here. So for example, the detector I was talking about with these hexagonal cells and these different layers, this is essentially what comes out to be, right? Like this is a, for example, in this particular square. So this I'm taking as a projection in the beam direction. This small thing here is referring to some sort of a jet. So a quark or gluon pass through. Okay. But then you can really go in the depth of it and really see what exactly might have happened. So you can really do a 3D clustering. Right? So, but then it's really what we call it here, a five-dimension imaging. I think it's 3D is still underestimation, because we can also see how the energy is evolving. Because when you go for the electromagnetic shower and hadronic shower, which is for the pion constituents, they have a lot of interesting stuff. That's what Shubham is studying actually. Okay, so then we call it, okay, fine, we can get the four momentum, we can get the longitudinal transfer shower profiles, and we can do a lot of imaging with respect to these detectors to try to identify the particles more efficiently and with higher resolution. And this is one of my interests, to go in the machine learning techniques, but also like towards like try to see if we can code up these in FPGAs. Now, why that is needed? So the detail here is that I have, what I did not mention is this. So for example, this one. So if we talk about the PP interaction rate, that's huge. That's of the order of nanobands. Okay, and let's focus on this vertical line here. We are talking about the electroweak production, WZ or the high PT jets, we are somewhere here of the order of 10 to the power 7. But when we talk about the supersymmetry and all, that is all below this. It's not even shown in this scale, below Higgs masses, for example. Okay, so what happens is that we are really producing 60 terabyte of data per second, and we are not going to store that. That's not possible. We can just cannot write it. So as a matter of fact, what happened, what we call trigger, is essentially this one. So we start with 40 megahertz, we quickly scan through the detector and try to see in the front end electronics pipelines, and we store the signal and see whether some interesting happened in the detector or not. So that brings down the 40 megahertz to 100 kilohertz, and we throw away rest of the events. Okay, then we do some sort of a high level triggering. So basically we try to study further, like the kind of events I have showed. We do it quickly in real time. That is of the order of a second. And there are huge processing farms. The GPU, now we are moving to GPU, right now CPU processor farms. So at the end, what I'm writing to my tape is essentially 500 hertz or 1 kilohertz at the most right now. We just cannot go to that level. Okay, now all these trigger algorithms, that whether something interesting happened or not, that is now moving to GPU as well as to the FPGAs, because there is some sort of a power consumption which is much less than FPGA. So those things I think I would be interested in if there is anyone of technical mind, but right now I haven't started. So one of my students, she might have been your TA, Alpna, she has been looking into some of these things, but not yet full-fledged. So going towards that. So for quantum computing thing, I can provide you, if you're really interested, I can provide you some links. We can look into the some of this stuff. Quantum computing as well as the quantum information, both are being sort of looked into.
Yes, thank you, ma'am. And I had one more question, not really related to the physics of it,
mm-hmm.
but how do, so I mean, I imagine like lots of people would be wanting to conduct experiments on the LHC. So like, do they submit proposals and then are they reviewed or?
No. So what happens is that, so there are different things which happens. Like, so the LHC one are the standard. What we're talking about the collisions, that is same for everyone. Okay. Because the it's a very complicated accelerator chain, right? So, but then what happens in addition to this, whatever the most high energy physics we are doing, so that's a common data for everyone. The organization goes that, okay, fine, once we have the common data, then how do we go about analyzing, right? It can be like 2000 authors and they don't all want to same do the same thing. So then the physics is organized in that way. Like, for example, we have 9 physics groups. One is doing like standard model physics. One is doing top physics. I'm involved with supersymmetry physics. I was also convener of the supersymmetry physics group for the CMS, taking care of the globally what is happening in CMS for the supersymmetry side. So this way, we sort of organize in that direction. So it's the same data, but we look at the different aspects of it. So this is what actually my idea was, putting this particular slide together, was that these are like from 3-5 different groups. Right, and the overlap of the events in these is very, very small. So your collision data has been separated down into the 5 different things, 5 different samples, right? Because of the selections we made. So that is the sort of an idea how it goes. But there are many, many other experiments going on, sir. Okay, there what happens, for example, I have this SPS, right? Now, from when the LHC is not running, so when the collision data is not happening, SPS can still run, okay? And there you can have the beams coming out of the order of up to 450 GeV protons. These protons, they can hit to a target and can give you secondary beams, what we call the pion beams or muon beams, or I think the neutrino one is not here at SPS. That's the Fermilab program. But we do have the muon beams, we have pion beams, we have electron positron beams, we have kyon beams, we have protons. Okay, so this TT20, what they are saying, these straight lines, they are essentially what we call test beam areas. Right, so what they do, we take this 450 GeV proton and really sort of shoot it on either Teflon or on the lead. So depending upon what is your target material, you can get the electron beam dominantly or you can get a hadron beam dominantly. Okay, so those kind of experiments keep happening, and they are also needed for our own prototype studies. So what Shubham did at CERN in 2018, this test beam, what I was showing the picture later, that's essentially one of the facilities that's where he worked. Okay, so this is essentially the, this is the his of the lab area. I don't have the picture of the H2 beam area. But that's essentially what it refers to. And then there are many sort of dedicated experiments which are searching for example, some of the axion dark matter. So those are the dedicated, again, or the beam dump experiments. Or there is also about this antiproton or anti-hydrogen experiments. So these are all going on. Like, for example, what they mentioned here, AWAKE, I'm forgetting this what exactly this is, but it's a new experiment. The ISOLD is another experiment. It's a collaboration. So these are studying the different, for example, some of them are studying CP violation properties. Some of them are really direct searches for the axions. Quite a few things are going on. But I haven't followed this on neutrino programs. I think they might have. I'm not very sure. I mean, there's definitely, because Dune and all, they are participating. It's just that I haven't followed in details. Any other questions? I mean, thanks to all of you that you are still connected.
It seems like there are no further questions. So thank you very much, ma'am, for this very informative talk.
Well, thanks a lot to all of you, and also for the opportunity to